three of the best speakers in the city of Chicago, and inshallah, y'all souls will be fed, your hearts will be nourished, and your minds will be enlightened. First up to that, you know, an introduction that I couldn't give. I mean, that word can't express, you know, what this man, what this brother has done for the souls and the hearts of human beings throughout America, throughout the world, and especially here in Chicago. Dr. Abdul Rasheed Matthews.
Assalamu alaikum. I thought he was talking about my brother right here. It is such a pleasure and honor to be on this side of the grass. And this day and time in which Allah Almighty is bringing hearts together from east to west, north to south. It's a great wisdom that we should look over carefully, and that in this gathering there is every nationality in the world gathered here, coming from the Middle East, Europe, Africa, to America. Many of our ancestors, the African Americans, brought here with the intentions of being servants of human beings, growing up and accepting Islam. Many of you coming from Islamic countries, trying to enhance your wealth and prosperity, coming to a place thinking that it will be milk and honey. Allah Almighty had a plan. And the plan was Islam. To have Islam to grow up in a place where it was considered the den of Satan. And I don't think that you are devil. When Beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was seeking his Lord, his whole intention and whole desire was for the happiness of human beings. For human beings to be in peace with themselves and in peace with their environment. He didn't know for a long time that Allah Almighty is God. Just like many times we have not realized, in spite of the current events, what's happening from east to west, north to south, that Allah Almighty is still God. If we were to say, and we had a loudspeaker, and we could say throughout the whole world, everyone look up at the sky. What is that round thing you see in the sky that's giving light and giving heat and rises in the morning and sets in the evening? Everyone would say, according to their language and according to their understanding, what it is. That's a sign of oneness. It is the same sun that Adam and Eve saw. It is the same sun that 124,000 prophets that have come on this earth saw. It is a reminder of the oneness, that there is a one God that has everyone's interest at heart, whether we understand it or not. So everything is to bring ourselves into a oneness of self, To understand self is to understand others. And so when the Prophet, peace be upon him, was in that cave, and he was given word from that he was seeking, Allah made it personal to him. He sent a guide to him in the person of Angel Jibril alayhi salam to guide him so that he may be a guide for humanity. And understanding the oneness and unity and harmony and peace and the tranquility and the love and the respect and the happiness that Allah Almighty intends for the human being. When a human being is at peace with themselves and happy in themselves and loving themselves, the power of a human being is that they transfer that to other human beings or creation. You cannot be in a place with someone who is entranquil and having love for their heart and do not and are not affected by that. By the same token, you're with someone who is disturbed in themselves, disconnected from themselves, do not know their creator in themselves, it's going to be hell. So Allah Almighty has allowed us to be temporarily on this side of the grass so that we may take something back from which we came from. Because Allah says, from Allah we come, Allah we shall return. So that we may learn that this side of the grass is only of chances of deception, and it putting it in our hearts only brings about a misery, because we can never, never, ever compare reality with something that is not reality. Let's go back to Esau ibn Maryam. Jesus Christ, as we know him, as many people know him, when he said that to seek ye the first the kingdom of heaven through righteousness, then all things will be given unto you. And he said to be in the world and not of the world. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 600 years, said, you're now coming from the small war of fighting each other to the big war of fighting ourselves, fighting anything that's going to come between you and your Lord, causing us to be in unity and peace and love and respect with ourselves, so that we may be an example, a living example of that among people. When the Prophet Muhammad came among the people, they were burying their daughters alive, they were worshiping idols. He didn't come and curse them out. He didn't come and condemn them. They didn't know that they were doing wrong. What he did, because he had the peace and love and connection to his Lord through himself, he was affecting them just by being around them, and they were able to feel and see his example and study how he interacted with people, and they wanted to be near him. Even his enemies were so curious that they wanted to be around him. And when he took Mecca, he didn't take it with a sword. When he came into Mecca, they were saying, how do you fight a war, a person who breaks down the walls of your heart? And that's why purification is half of our faith, as we begin to clean our hearts of anything that keeps us from the unity with ourselves, realizing and knowing our Lord and ourselves. We could never have unity. And Allah Almighty now, from east to west and north to south, is doing one thing. We're interpreting it as something bad, as something evil. But Allah Almighty
permit, there is not a leaf that falls that Allah Almighty is not aware of. It is not a mosquito that flaps his wing or her wing that Allah Almighty is not aware of. So you think Allah is not aware of what is going on in the world, on the planet, in the universe? Allah is God. And when we know that peace, we feel peace in our heart. We have patience in our actions. We have tolerance with those who do not understand yet. We have love for ourselves. And when we go among people, among any people, black people, white people, red people, brown people, Jews, Christians, Muslims, Hindus, fire workers, anybody, lie die in everybody, there is a feeling of peace and love that emanates from our heart, from our Lord Almighty. Like the sun that shines to the sky. You stay out there in that sun long enough, you go around somebody, they will feel the heat. It is not our heat. It is not our sun. It is not our love. It's not our light. It is the very one who has intended us to be in peace and happiness and unity. Thank you so much for listening. May Allah bless all of us. May Allah guide us to ourselves, because Allah says, Talbot Book for the Faith Allah, the heart of those sincere believers is the house of Allah Almighty, in which we become hospitable, because there's no greater hope than Allah Almighty. And when we are reaching that in ourselves, we are hospitable to everyone everywhere. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.
Yes, I'm like Mohammed. Everybody, give us 3 more takbir for our brother Dr. Abdul Rasheed. Takbir! 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 Oh my God. Yes, when you are feeling happiness in your heart, it's wise to praise the Lord, because He'll multiply that happiness. And so we do have a moderator for today's event who will explain to you how the sessions will go. You know, a very esteemed gentleman that does much work in the community and is always in support of good deeds. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, Amir Al Islam. Can I sit here?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم أما بعد. Brothers and sisters and guests and visitors, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. May the peace and blessings of Almighty Allah be with you today. I apologize for being delayed. We had I was at the hotel with Sister Akhira Shabazz, now his daughter, and her plane was delayed. So I was there and she's meeting with Meah Mohammed's daughter, having some conversation with her. I thought it would be a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this organization was able to facilitate that. I'd like to just say that I'm really blessed and honored to be here in this great city, and to live here, feel considered my home. And I'll just be facilitating questions and dialogue and discourse that we have with our esteemed panel. And our next first presenter is the brother Ibrahim, Imam Ibrahim. Imam Ibrahim,
you know. Okay. Come on. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I must say, this is the saddest group I've been in front of in a long time. I'm going to say it right. I mean, look at it. I didn't eat the breakfast. But as I sat here looking at people come, and even prior to coming, I very rarely think that I have something to say to people that they cannot find out in some other way, other than how they look to me. And you can tell me how I look, how I sound, how I seem to you. Everything else we can probably find in a book somewhere. I'm encouraged to speak to people about taking advantage of their own personal circumstances, which are different.
some of us have two parents that love each other. Brother and a sister and a fine home. And some of us may only have one parent that loves us and wonder where the other one is. But the point I'm making is that we were all delivered into different circumstances, and no matter how good your individual circumstances may seem to be, given the opportunity, we would pray to change something. Some little thing. Whether it's something in our children or something in ourselves or the length of our life. But like Dr. Abdul Rasheed says, it's just good to be on this side of the earth, because one day people will be walking over where we lay. We need to take advantage of the opportunity that we have above ground to interact with people and circumstances in such a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with us. Now, when we know that a smile in the face of your brother is like unto charity, it bewilders me why Muslims frown at each other. I'm not necessarily talking about this group, but when we know that a smile is like unto charity, see, but what happens too often in our address is brothers want to go up and smile at the sisters. No, you're supposed to smile at the brothers. Let the sisters smile at the sisters. And when we establish a behavior that is constantly mindful of our circumstances, some of you work in hospitals, some of you are students, some of you may be looking for a job, some of you have got too old to work. I'm just looking at you. No, I happen to look at Brother Idris because he didn't recognize me, but I recognized him because of his distinct patch of hair. But we went to the I.M.A.N training program in 1978 in Naperville, Illinois. It was the first. It was sponsored by the Ministry of Education from Saudi Arabia. And it was a wonderful program. They ran the whole North Central College. We like owned that school during that period of time. We had some very distinguished instructors that helped us to establish a sense of acceptance. See, because too many Muslims that are born overseas and they come to America, they like to tell you, well, I'm born Muslim. Everything is born Muslim. And it is the parents that lead the children to or away from that particular way of life. We're all born in a state of Hanif Sitra, upright by our very nature. So when we accept Islam as a way of life, accept it. Say, for instance, what we come to find out as Muslim Americans, we're moving into our third generation. We almost lost the first generation of children because we really didn't know what to do. We got two young men in jail right now for murder and some others for various crimes because it was very difficult for them to blend what their parents were forcing on them out of Islam as a way of life, while still having them participating in the non-Muslim way of life in school and going and coming. So that's a very delicate balance that we need to be mindful of. And each and every one of you, I see more young people than older people, but what I'm reminded of is that many of you, your parents were born India, Pakistan, Jordan, Palestine, Saudi Arabia, some other country. And they came here for whatever reason. But most of the people who came here and subsequently practiced Islam, they didn't come here for Islamic reasons. They came here to improve their way of life, to make money, get education, and they come to find out that this is no place to be without deen. This is no place to be without a belief that leads to a practice that restricts your particular behavior. Less than 15 miles from here, there are people that are, we're in a state of dress, they're in a state of extreme undress. And were not the law, they would wear nothing. And I had to ask my son, how can people walk around with no shirts on? I don't understand it. I feel uncomfortable in my house like that. Because we develop a sense of decorum, of what's right and what's not right. So again, I don't have anything to say to you that you couldn't say to me. But in terms of making this lifestyle that we call Islam a reality, the Islam got two parts. most of us are clear on the first part, that's the believing part. The other part is the practice. We have to be able to interact in any particular situation according to our belief. Our beliefs don't change, but the situation changes, the circumstances change. And the more I look around, the more I realize that there's much work to be done. This part here, whether some of you know it or not, this is a very infamous park. Martin Luther King Jr. was attacked right here in Marquette Park. The march was on one side or the other of this particular park, and we couldn't be doing this a number of years ago under no circumstances. The time has changed. I think we need to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for people like Rami, Nashashibi, who, for whatever reason, is motivated. He's motivated to do things that make a difference. And taking it to the street is merely an institution. You know, what, rather than every other year, it may have to become a yearly activity. But I call on each and every one of you to wake yourselves up. Recognize that, or accept the fact, or ask the question, in the event that all the rest of us decided that we do with this Islam. Would Islam live or die based on you? Would Islam live or die based on how you practice it? And then the rest of us say it's on you. But whether we say it or not, it is on you. When we are raised, there'll be one at a time. And we'll all be called to account for how we spend our time, how we spend our youth, how we spend our health, how we spend our wealth. So let's be prepared to answer those questions by acting in such a way where we will turn this time into a loss of our dollar, like this time here. And
he's doing.
Remembering Allah. Allah deserves to be remembered at every time and every place. You can remember Allah when you're doing anything. Maybe not in the same particular way, but Allah can be remembered anywhere, anytime, and under any circumstances. So I will turn this back over to my esteemed brother. He says, Amir Al Islam. Now that's Amir Al Islam. And I think it would be good for a lot of you young people to really know what Islam was in Chicago while you were being nursed and enjoying nursery school and these things, because Islam was not what it is. See, many of us live with a post-911 mentality. But Islam was the same thing pre-911. As far as America is concerned, anything that you were seriously practicing it as a way of life. So, Amir Al Islam has a very unique and distinct history in Islam in America. Dr. Abdul Rasheed does. Dr. Mikhail Ramadan does. Also in medicine, in dentistry. And we are only your elders in that case. Now, look out here, a lot of you young people, it's time for y'all to take over. We should be relaxing, you know, watching you sweat, coming, seeking consultation and a sense of direction based on what went before you, really. We accepted Islam in 1969 and 70, and after we were teenagers, we really thought that we would take over America by the time we were 25 and the world by 35. We believed it. Why? Look at how America came into being. All those people, they were in their 20s. The people who signed the Declaration of Independence, they weren't old people. They were in their 20s and their 30s. So we truly thought that we would be living in Mecca and Medina and Munawara, making the decisions about who would come and who would go because of our sincerity, because of our readiness. We used to dress in uniform, we walked up in the street, we salute. Because we were gung-ho like that. I mean, we recognized that we had been entrusted with something that had power, worth, value, and it was ours to share without losing. You can give someone Islam and keep it and benefit from how they do it. So Islam is such a precious way of life, we really expected to do differently. We didn't give up the belief. We still praise and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the same sincerity, if not more. Because now we know Him better. And to put it even better, we know ourselves better. So I encourage you to, you know, find your place. Accept your responsibility. Wherever you work, wherever you spend your time, it's your responsibility to practice Al-Islam in that place. No vacations, no days off. You can't take no days off from Islam. I mean, not really, no vacation, but we got too many Juma go to meeting Muslims. Like you said, the old Sunday go to church Christians. Too many Juma go to meeting Muslims. Well, the only Islam they know is Salatul Juma, and then they come late, leave early. I conduct Salatul Juma every week for 30 years. That's the way it is. In the event we act as though people don't know that the one who comes early with the right intent gets the camel. But I guess camels don't mean anything else. The camel had to commit suicide. I mean, they don't care. So we have to, you know, let's say you get a brand new rose or something, something that makes some sense of meaning in your life or our life. I mean, you know, you and me too. So we need to do more and better with whatever little bit of time we got left, as long as we know. In closing, life is just a bus stop. Don't set up house. Wait for the bus, driven by the angel of death.
That's it.
Love my God.
Dedicated their time for the service of Allah. Next event is Dr. Ramadan. Bob Lambert.
Thank you.
A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajeem. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is, as my brothers have said, indeed a pleasure to be here before you. And I enjoy looking out at your faces, with the beautiful diversity of faces that I see in here. Our assignment was to address you for 10 minutes and on a subject of unity. Hold fast to the rope of Allah. And I was very pleased to get this title, because I think it's something that, a prescription that we need today, if I were to take a medical perspective on our problem. I think this is a wonderful therapy, unity, hold fast to the rope of Allah. I want to start my quick 10 minutes here. Inshallah, we can hold to that. The source of unity is the revelation from Allah. And how is that? Because there is one creator, one creation, and that creation is cared for and sustained by that creator. Unity is in complete accord with the pattern under which Almighty God Allah made us. So, when we look, as you're sitting there, and we look on this hill behind us, you see the trees and the grass and the birds and the sun. You look to your right there, you see the lake. You see how all of these things work together. They make a beautiful environment for us. You look at yourself, you see your hands, your fingers, your eyes, your brain. All of it works together. In unity. There's a pattern of unity that exists throughout Allah's creation. You don't have to look far, just look at yourself, and you'll see that same underlying pattern of unity. You say, if unity is everywhere, why do we have to address unity as though it was something strange or something that we don't have? Because that's the situation. Unity, even though it's natural and normal, and the normal state of affairs, we suffer from lack of unity. So in a few minutes, it's important for us to look at not only the concept of unity, but what causes disunity. To come to unity, which is the plan of Allah, it requires love of Allah. It also requires fear of Allah alone. And it also requires us to remove from our hearts anything like selfishness, fear of others, and suspicion. You see, dear beloved brothers and sisters, the challenge for us as human beings is for us to understand that all of the things that we have are indeed blessings from Almighty God Allah. It's so easy for us to get proud of the things that we have. I have education. I have wealth. I have status. I have lineage. I have background. My people have this. It is easy for us to get proud of those things. And as soon as we begin to get proud, we don't realize that we elevate that issue right up to the status of an idol. And before we know it, it's sharing a place in our psyche along with Allah. That is the source of disunity. Where does that come from? Where did that start? That started with Iblis. Remember him? Oh yeah, remember Iblis? Iblis attempted to undermine Allah's blessing to us when he said, I am better than he. I am better than he. Famous words, okay? Because we say them in so many different ways today. We don't think I'm better than him. But we say, we were here first. Another way of saying the same thing. We proudly say, all of this came through us. Another way of saying, and that makes me better than you. Or, we got it last, and we got the best of it. Another way of saying, I'm better than you as a result. Or that we are the best. Same word. Or saying, it's our turn now. Another way of saying, and I'm better than you as a result because it's my turn to be on top. Think about what we're saying, dear beloved brothers and sisters. We're saying those things that work against the unity of the Ummah. In that topic, hold fast to the rope of Allah. Almighty God Allah says in Quran 3:103, and this is Yusuf Ali's translation, and hold fast altogether by the rope which Allah stretches out for you, and be not divided among yourselves, and remember with gratitude Allah's favor on you, for you were enemies and he joined your hearts in love, so that by his grace you become brethren, and you were on the brink of the pit of fire, and he saved you from it. Thus does Allah make his signs clear to you, that you may be guided. And Allah teaches to you. When we look at the beautiful metaphor of a rope, it has significance for us. Because it implies a rope of rescue. A rope of rescue. And a rope that rescues is actually the flexible extension of somebody's hand. Okay? That rope can pull us up. That rope can pull us together. That rope can pull us away from something. That rope can pull us to safety. And a rope can also restrain us when we might hurt ourselves or hurt somebody else.
and also a rope can secure us from being blown away in life's storm. Is that right? If you've been on a boat in a squall or bad weather, you might have to wrap yourself down with a rope, right? So it doesn't blow you overboard. So in high winds, in a storm, or when you're afraid you might fall, you put a rope on you. So if I do fall, I will only go down so far. And that's what the implication of a rope is. So we want to hold fast to the rope that Allah extends to us, because it is a rope of rescue. So at this time, we want to hope we hit our 10 minutes. But the unity of this ummah is so important. It's the natural state. It's important to get rid of those things that cause disunity, and unity results, since it is a natural state. If my shoulder was dislocated, all I have to do is give it a pull, and it jumps back into place, and it's happy again. Same thing with us. All you have to do to that ummah that's dislocated is give it a pull, and it will jump back into place in unity. Allahu Akbar. Allahu
Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
Before we open up the floor for some very kind of down-to-earth, honest dialogue, which I would like to kind of help mediate, I want to take the privilege of framing what I think should be critical in terms of our conversation. And I want to divide into two areas. One has to do with the Quranic, the Islamic instruction, a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dealing with the notion of unity, and some very practical aspects of how that happens on the ground. As you know, the Quran says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, wa'atakimu bihablillahi jami'an wa la tafarraq. Hold fast to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and be not divided among yourselves. This is not a recommendation from Allah. This is a command from Allah. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our model of that. لَكَدْ كَنَ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. You have in the personality and the character of the Prophet Muhammad the perfect model of conduct. So when we talk about the instructions and the exegesis and the canons and the instructions of Islam, and we talk about and we look and review the actual implementation of that in reality, we see a disconnect. There is a disconnect between what Allah instructs us and commands us to do and what we actually practice on the ground. Now, from a very practical perspective, and we need to have conversations about this. When we talk about the idea of unity, there is a divide in the community around racial issues. Imam Ibrahim used to say this almost 30 years, he was talking about this 30 years ago. The reality is we need to have a real conversation about the reality and not be in denial about the reality of what exists in our community. There is a divide in this polarization of ethnicity. Now, we as African Americans have often been subject to the hardest edge of this process. Because often, because of the global message of people of color being less than others, we have been victimized by this notion of inferiority that we have to carry with us and we have to constantly battle against. That it's not over. If I walk around in New York City in an Armani suit, I can't get a cab because of the moniker of the pigmentation of my skin, and I still suffer the indignities of racism every single day in the 21st century. So now, I have some real problems when I'm subjected to that kind of sentimentality, oppression, and hegemony.
when it relates to my own Muslim brothers and sisters from another part of the world, who have been often, unfortunately, affected by this kind of global meta-narrative of race. So this exists in our community. It is a reality, and unfortunately we have never had conversations about it because, theoretically, ideally, we say there is no racism in Islam. There is no racism in Islam. There is, however, racism in Muslims. So we need to start having real conversations about this. And let us not be in denial about the reality. Now, as it relates to even indigenous people, as far as African Americans are concerned, we are fragmented along the lines of these are Sufis, these are Jamaat Tablighi, these are Salafis, these are, because, and we fragment ourselves in 1,000 pieces. When in fact, finally, they're busting African Americans who are coming out of prison in this state. 61% of African Americans are the population, inmate population in this state alone is African American. Many of them, they're busting them in every month coming into the community. Do we have the capacity to address the challenges that they tell you, I can give you a hadith, but can you give me a job? Are my institutions set up in such a way where I can address the real problems on the ground that people have every single day? So we are facing an onslaught, and I can give you a whole talk on popular culture and the ramifications and the impact of what is happening and how that we can have it among young people. We can have a long conversation about Muslim young people and where they are, the majority of them, if you want to talk to people. So I want to kind of frame our discourse and conversation on kind of an existential reality so that we don't get caught in this dream state and romanticism that we often all find ourselves, because we know that Islam and Islamic dogma and Islamic teaching are such ideals and such and so wonderful. But the reality on the ground is we need to really do an assessment of where we really are and how we can move from where we are now into the future. And I don't want to diminish the contributions that all of us are making. We all been soldiers, but we are facing much more formidable challenges, and we've got to ramp up and prepare ourselves for the reality that exists all around us. So having said that, I'd like for us to open up the conversation with you. As Imam Ibrahim said, this is part of a learning teaching. We have conversations, questions, comments, anything that you would like. The mic is right in the middle. And let's have a serious conversation. I don't want to hear anything about Gloriana. I read it on AM this morning. So I don't need any platitude, any great stories.
Sorry, girl. I don't have a question particularly, but I'm going to have a quick one. And just say what I've learned over the past week about this. I did a program that has been addressing racism a lot, especially racial inequity in the education system. We know that racism exists, right? Like, it's evident all around us. If we take 10-year-olds or half-year-old 10-year-olds in the north side and in the south side, this has nothing to do with that, it's just like the nature of community that we're in the north and the south side. And we see if we compare their educational levels, we know that the 10-year-olds, the black 10-year-olds are sued for life because of the simple unevenness or like the disadvantage they have in the education system starts from day one. And this is the same problem we need to address as like a Chicago community. We need to address the Chicago public school system, the equity inherent in them. And because education, like, kids are the disadvantage to really have. And once we do that, I think I'm just often speaking here. Yeah, I think I'm just going to be now, why racism within the Muslim community? I feel that Muslims, like other racist people, or like some racist Muslims, like other racist people, feel that black people could be inherited, like the problem inherited in their culture, that, you know, it's much more likely for them to do drugs or engage in violence or not care about education. But, and this is a view that many people have, but we need to know how the media presents this, right? Now, We see this through the eyes of the news and like the media that like black people are more involved in drugs. Like this is, I'm just saying what people are thinking of. This is no way the process is what I But we have, there was a report that was published recently that addressed the statistics of the number of black people are getting accused of rape or drug addiction. Four out of five people who were arrested for drug trade were black. Now, how are we supposed to take this, right? How are we supposed to take this? Well, we have to, four out of five people were arrested. That's a key word. Like, they are being singled out by, like, the police and were put into the jail process, and that's how we are viewing this. So, my point is that, it's how we take it. Why do some black people are getting arrested? White people take more drugs. They show studies have shown that white people take more drugs than black people. But black people are getting arrested. Why? Because there's more open spaces in black communities for people to be recognized as drug takers. There's more open spaces in white communities. We have a very secluded that a community where a police force isn't tracking around looking for black people boarding the jail. That's happening in the South Side. So I think that's where like education is targeted and the media and how they present the news of the jail. And how we take in the news. Like, the students don't mean anything to take look at the context of where they're coming from. Sorry, I have another question and that was just my piece.
Would you like to respond?
I was listening very carefully to your presentation, young sister, and I think you have a very accurate perception of what is happening. But how do we respond to it is another situation altogether. And you think that we're able to spread the perception, you need to speak to your parents and your aunts and your uncles because, like it or not, they're part of the problem. They bought into the system that is in place, and you are, and your generation are opting out of it because you can recognize the inherent unfairness of it. But speak to your parents, speak to your neighbors, and do what you can.
Alhamdulillah, that could have been responded to in many different ways, but we don't keep it simple. The fact is, what we're talking about is the unity. How is it that the Rasul of Islam galvanized the people, the different tribes, the different classes, and the different nations, is the focus. What are we doing, or what are we not doing, that needs to be done and incorporated to the mindset? Because what the sister did and any other question is just reflective of an illness, not going to what caused the illness. So we need to go directly, as the brother said, what is the illness that is affecting all of us? Because there's no singling out of any race. Because we know all races are singling out if they say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. They have made that plain. So let's keep it plain. And on that level, dealing with the reality of, even though we're here now, you brought up Martin Luther King was here and the racism that he had to endure. But we also have to look at the fact that what is pluralism, how does pluralism play a part of this, and how does secularism play a part of this, because those are the two ideological perspectives that we have been cultured and cultivated with that has dominated that over the Islamic Aqeedah. So inshallah, can y'all expand on that?
I'm glad to hear, I was glad to hear her comments, and I was glad to hear your summary. She brought up a number of points that they were true. They were true, and the facts were true, and the perceptions also that she was addressing were true. And she was asking, well, how, I could hear in her question, how should we be dealing with this? And what way should we be handling this information as it's coming to us? And I also very much like your question, what is the Islamic solution to these problems? And I think not to be too abrupt, but we have to ask ourselves,
what would Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have done? What would he have done in this situation? And I think the Christians have to ask themselves, what would Jesus Christ have done? Was he here dealing with what they have to deal with? And similarly, the Jews have to ask themselves, how would Moses have dealt with this situation? Prayer and peace be upon the prophet. That's a quick shorthand answer to your question. But it's a thing that I think we have to bring to our mind, because she also pointed, a brother pointed out, Brother Imam, that there's no racism in Islam, but there's racism in Muslims. So that is a problem that has to be dealt with. So we have to do some introspection. We have to look into our hearts and delve deep in there to see what is it that's still in there that's allowing that to exist in my perception. We have to ask ourselves that and dig there first. Because we're not going to change anything until we first change what's deep in our hearts. Allah tells us. So it is, after we say that, we have to tell that we have to, as Muslims, fight injustices. We cannot be hesitant when we see wrongs being perpetrated against any people. We have to stand up against those wrongs. We have to be a people for justice. We have to be a witness for God. That's how we fight. We fight injustices. We fight as a witness for God. And we ask, is this the way that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would do it if he were here right now and having to make this decision or facing these issues? Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. I'd just like to just to piggyback on that. But first of all, my brother Islam, I'm glad to see him go back so far, and he still looks like a teenager. He's about 95, but he looks like a teenager. But he and the other brothers are examples of the process and the method that the Prophet Muhammad SAW brought. You just can't read a hadith or read the Quran and then go out in the world and think things are going to change. No, we have to practice that method. It's a process. We have forgotten. Shaitan has convinced us that he does not exist. We don't know enough about that part of us that rebels against Allah Almighty, which is the ego. When Allah created the ego, he told the ego to come forward. It went backward. He told it to go backward. It came forward. He asked the ego, who am I? The ego says, I am me and you are you. So the whole training of Islam, the method, is to get the ego to say there is no God but God. So Islam is first established in ourselves before we take it to someone else. Prophet Muhammad, when he came out of that cave, he didn't tell the people they had to start fasting and praying. Allah, it was a process. He went among them with good conduct. He brought about a God consciousness to them. And that's why everything he did, when he walked into a mosque, when he greeted someone, it was out of a God consciousness. Because that is what Allah Almighty has placed in us to return to Allah. That is our frame of reference that the method and the process returns us to. Allah says, I'm always pleased with those who are off returning to their Lord. In ourselves, we forget that. Our egos, everyone wants everyone to respect them and not respect anyone else. We all come from the same Lord. We all return to the same Lord. No one is better than anyone else except through their God consciousness. Shaitan is real. Don't doubt that. The ego, that part of us is rebellious. It is real. It is a power, but we have to understand the nature of it. It's a process, and our practice, our discipline of fasting and praying and greeting people without expecting them to greet us, and extending
hospitality and friendship and reaching out. Charity to give to. See, Allah says in the Quran that you think that when you give of your wealth, you are decreasing it, but in reality, you are increasing it. That's how we have to live. It's a process. That is the story of the process. We forget that.
Assalamualaikum. Dealing with the disunity or the fragmentation of the Muslims in Chicago, I'm just dealing with Chicago here. We have a lot of division here, and I think it's incumbent upon the leadership in these particular messages to start making some effort for these other messages or leadership in the other messages, because I'm the staff captain of the Cook County Jail. I'm the Cook County Jail. I'm the staff captain. Yeah. And we have very low participation from the Muslims in Chicago in that kind of jail. Very low participation. And we talk about recidivism, we talk about the drugs, we talk about little Johnny running around the pistol and all this here. And these Muslims are being affected by this here. And inside there, they talk about the particular messages they patronize in the media. So the leadership in Chicago, basically referring to the indigenous Muslims, the leadership in Chicago, that's where the hard men need to start it. And y'all need to start getting things up and asking this for the leadership there, and so we can close these gaps. So let's hear from around there.
I would like to talk about whenever we received the call, we would go to that prison and respond to that person or those people. We would conduct humor services, we would be there for Eid, whatever we could do. And what we found out is too many incarcerated persons take cover under Islam while they're incarcerated, but when they're out of the prison, the masjid is the last place they want to get to. It was too much so in our case. While we were attending to the people in jail, we neglected our children. So now we have some of our children in jail, and the people that we attended to are out here running the streets. So you have to be able to establish your own priorities. What is the most important thing for me to do with the few dollars I have, with the little time that I have, and the little energy that I have? Because the few dollars won't take care of all of the needs. My energy can't respond to all of the needs, and my time won't. So I recognize you as the leader of the Cook County effort. I would respond to you in a very specific sense, but we stopped answering letters and we stopped taking collect phone calls because that simply did not work for us. Mm-hmm. Now, in the event that we're able to establish a relationship with a chaplain rather than the prisoner direct, then we can in turn hold you responsible for the people that you put us in contact with, whether you brought them to Islam or whether you just worked with them while they're incarcerated. There is a gap that exists from the time they leave the prison to where they should be going. And we saw our energy as being diminished, and our resources and our time have been not appreciated. And as a result, when we visit prisons now, we're visiting our own children. Mm-hmm. And unless you recommend somebody in particular, we won't be coming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, coming. I'm yeah. Well, you know, we just talking about one brother going one unit 2 hours.
Whatever we're talking about, we would want to coordinate through a responsible person.
Okay, I'm responsible, brother, and we'll get together.
Okay.
But the task, it's not even like that. Because we have to look toward ourselves. See, we gave up and didn't have an effect on everybody in the jailhouse.
When you say we come on.
We Muslims
that felt as though, because the presence of Allah in you, that our resources were being drained, that our efforts were useless.
Mm-hmm.
Those Muslims who put tawfiq in Allah, or Allah gave them the tawfiq to be able to go in there and to make salat, those that have that idea that their efforts were useless, we gave up on that environment. So then even if our children did get away from us, they still can't walk from us in jail because we affected that environment too. And maybe our kids would get it in jail.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they would get it in jail. Because see, we can't be with our children 24/7. We can't control the TV, the radio. Our sons go and learn how they become hafiz of Quran, but you don't know what they listened to before they got to the madrasa, and what they're going to listen to when they get out of the madrasa, and what they're going to listen to during the break time.
So all I'm saying is,
if we, the leadership, tell our membership that whatever effort those brothers over there are doing on the website, support them. Whatever those brothers over there support them, don't constantly ostracize them just because they're submitting Jama'at.
Mm-hmm.
Or ostracize them because they're celibate. Or ostracize them because they follow the Indian scholarship. Or ostracize them because they follow the Arab scholarship. That's what we do here. That's reality here.
Yeah.
We need to stop that.
Let me respond to that too. I think you brought a very important point. You see, the notion of unity among leadership, we're talking specifically among indigenous African Americans, there has to be a culture of leadership created in the community. This is an ongoing struggle around notions of tribalism, ethnicity, race, and what have you. That's part of the, said, this is part of the jihad that we have to do in terms of jihad of not mediating those conflicts. Because the Prophet didn't promise us that we wouldn't have conflict. He didn't promise us that the roads of Islam would be paved with roses and everything would be easy. But he gave us a methodology, a minhaj that allows us to address the challenges that we face on a regular basis. Now finally, when we talk about the idea of imams coming together in Chicago, how do you, and as the brother was saying, how do you look at someone who has basically been influenced by the work of Jama'at Tabligh? How do you look at someone who has been influenced/educated by the Salafi movement? How do you look at those people who come also from the same ethnic composition? How do they look at each other? And the issue becomes, we have to be able to have create a dialogical process that allows us to talk with each other around issues. We're not going to have the same interpretation of Islam, and that's fine. But that does not mean that you can't rally to the day table to talk about issues that are common to the general Muslim ummah. Because we're accountable to the whole Muslim community. It's not, and often we have almost Christianized Islam. If you belong to this mosque, like a Christian would say, I belong to this church. I belong to this mosque, that mosque. If you are an imam and you serve the Muslim ummah, when you say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, then I have rights over you as a Muslim. That's the only community I need to join in order for me to exercise my rights over you and you to be honored by your life. So this does not come just automatically. It comes with sitting down to the table, and I've been involved in these conversations since the 1970s. Almost 30 years with leaders, because I love leaders, I study them, I study leadership, and would never want to be one. Because I know at 3 o'clock in the morning, they're talking to you, trying to mediate your family issues. And you're not, with no insurance plan, not enough money. One of the reasons your mom couldn't come, he didn't have enough money to come here. Because the congregation could not support him, because the infrastructure is not there. So now he doesn't have health care insurance, he can't even get a teacher. Because this is the congregation that they're serving on a day-to-day basis selflessly. 500 to 600 mosques in the country, African American indigenous people. How many Islamic institutions do we have to teach Islam? They have to primarily go abroad. And often when they go abroad, they bring back something other than the teachings of Islam. They bring back cultural baggage that often does a disservice to our needs. And finally, as I said, Imam Rashid, I have to say this publicly, he took a position a long time ago that if I'm going to be in this
practicing Islam and I'm going to be falling upon this tradition, I'm going to empower myself. I'm not going to let someone else determine my destiny. I'm going to be self-determined, even in my Islamic practice, where I'm going to be attentive to the particularity of the culture and the need of my own people, the people in which I immerse. Father, so I come to say, deny who you came, where you came from, who you were. This is what honors us. Allah says what? He created, well, that means, وَجَلَّكُمْ تُعُوبًا وَخَبَعِلَا لِتَعَرَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهِ يَحْقَاتُ. I created your nations and tribes so that you might learn and know from one another. So we respect and celebrate difference. And embrace it. And we embrace it in such a way where we appreciate it. But now when it gets to the point where, as the sister says, where people begin to start thinking you have criminal inclination. Because every time they see on TV, they got a black man with handcuffs on. And you think that they are committing most of the time. And when you get this impression in your mind, you don't have an engagement. You see, you have to reach out to people in business. You have to reach out to them because often racism is benign and subtle. It's not necessarily intentional racism, but it's affected by racialized thinking that is part of a global narrative that we are affected by. And also the media. We see in the media, we see all the misrepresentations of Africa, people of African ancestry, every single day. Think about it. When was the last time you saw an African-American young male on television with a positive image? Think about that. That's how we're being programmed in this culture, in this society. So we have to oppose that and fight against that. And so, but we got to have conversations. Don't come and tell me that, alhamdulillah, we all Muslims, and then, next thing I know, you won't get in Salaam. And another thing, I'm involved with both communities. I've been involved with both communities over 30, 40 years. Sister came to me, I want to marry an African American, South Asian. You got to be crazy. That's what your parents say. His parents said, no, we're not having it. Well, he graduated with an MBA from Harvard, was born in a Muslim family, and going to get his PhD. But he's still not qualified to marry my daughter. Why? Muslim being in all his life, family being, it is because of the notion of this global meta-narrative of race that has categorized us in a particular positionality that marginalizes and demonizes us. So we come to the table perceived to have a disadvantage. So we have to overcome that even with our Muslim brothers and sisters. It's always, it's constant, it's ongoing. And I'm not saying that we need to be marrying a bunch of immigrants. I ain't trying to marry my son to nobody else. But if he needs to be somebody who wants to marry, it's fine. But I'm constantly in this struggle to deconstruct this notion of race in the minds of people who have racism, whether it's Muslim community or non-Muslim. That's what we have to do on a regular basis. And you, we never get over it. It never stops. We start in the Muslim community. I remember we find a good Sahara, now we're in the Muslim. Oh my, this is what, oh my, this is what it got. We down. We all won, y'all, let's fuck up. My brothers from the continent, my brothers from South Asia, my Arab brothers, what's up? They're like, hard to get a good handshake. But what's wrong with me? Is there something wrong with me? Because I'm still trying to not look and understand myself through the eyes of others because they have already told me that I am less than them. So now I'm facing this in the Muslim community. See, I'm going to get up and say, brother, this is what we got to talk about. Let's talk about this. Because I'm not going to just go around and say y'all racist and I say that. If people give a racism a package, then racism was benign or overt. And I'm going to sit around and say, you need to talk about this. Because, as Dr. Rasheed said, the reality is Allah has already made that clear. So that's part of Satan's mission to keep us divided. So we really got to overcome that. All of the vision, particularly as we talk about a post-9/11 world, do you realize where we're living? Do you understand that I'm sitting in a Nashashibi not a couple of weeks ago in New York and there's a listening device coming out of the library? You understand what I'm saying? My friends personally are stopped at the border. Strip searched almost every time they get on an airplane in African America. You understand what I'm saying? This is the reality that we face in intelligence communities in our community. Reviewing what we're doing, what we're talking about. Being indicted because of your intention to even want to talk about a status in Islamic State. That you're branded and Islamic.
where the people are trying to determine whether or not you are a liberal Muslim, or you a moderate Muslim, or you a radical Muslim. And if you are a radical Muslim, we got problems with you. Now you're interpreting my Islam, and you tell me what books I should be reading. If I'm reading Mal Duty, it's questionable. If I'm reading anything about the Quran Muslim, it's questionable. Because I become suspect. And you all from the immigrant community need to understand, as Muslims, it's like being black twice when you ask a man as a Muslim. It's like first you black, so you already jammed, and then you're a Muslim in a Judeo-Christian dominated society. So it's like we are like carrying a double burden here. You understand what I'm saying? I want you to know this, because, you know, as the brother said, I'm glad that sister knows this much about what's happening to black people, because most people don't. But you're dealing with your own world and your own lives and your own struggles and your own issues. But Allah says, that you might learn from one another. So this is part of the dialogical process, and we have conversations with each other. Stop saying so long. That's right.
All right. I just want to say that I truly believe that America really is a blessing for Muslims in many ways. And one of the ways it's a blessing for Muslims is because we've got freedoms here to practice our religion, to practice our faith, where some of these freedoms do not even exist in some of the Muslim countries around there. And this is also another blessing that we have, is that we've got Muslims from all over coming here in America, where Allah has placed us on a land where we can get to know each other again, where it's a lot of times that sort of personal relationship between different ethnicities and groups sort of got diluted and lost. Now the question I have is, if we in America can get along as Muslims and learn to love one another, to get along, to really consider ourselves brothers and sisters on a micro level in America, what sort of impact would that have on a macro level dealing with global Islam?
The question I had was, if we learn to get along with two Muslims here in America from different ethnic backgrounds and cultural backgrounds on a micro level, what impact would that have on Islam globally on a macro level?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the word of Quran, This is a prayer from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gives us the Prophet the major prayer. That's we finish every meeting. And it calls us to understand the whole idea that we are going to be losers. We're going to lose in the end as long as we don't come together and mutually mature over things, just the way it is land. Not only that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned us that he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we should never stop fighting the shaitan. He said because the shaitan, until the shaitan stops fighting us, and the shaitan will fight you forever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there to protect us. This disunity among Muslims is an act of shaitan, because shaitan is here to divide us. His job, that's what he is here to do. But the parallel being, we as Muslims, we are not just to make it a better place for Muslims, but a better world for humanity. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't come as a messenger for just the Muslims. He came as a Rami said, I.M.A.N. He came for all the people, from this time to the end of time. So the parallel, our problem is the fact that it boils down to when one of the Sahabas asked of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why is it come to this effect? Why is it the people won't come together and pray and zikr and, you know, what keeps them, you know, from doing this? Why don't they come together like that, unity? And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam answered with one word. He said, the dunya, the hate of the dunya, the life of this world, we get caught up in this world and we forget that there's a better world coming. You know, not only is it a better world, I'm out there, it's ever, it's forever. So we live too much for this life, and we forget about the next life. We take on the ideas and the concepts of the environment that we're placed in, and when we should be having an effect on it. Muslims right now should be leading the world. Should be the leaders of the world. Why? Because we have the best knowledge. We have the best being. A being that was perfected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our problem is when we try to fight dunya with dunya. In order to get ahead in this world, I'm going to go get me a college degree, and I'm going to get a job and a career, and I'm going to make a lot of money, and I'm going to be successful. That's not where the success is. That's not where the success is. The success is in this life, in the grave, and in the next life. And the only way we're going to do that, we have to fight this journey with the being. We have to fight it with being. Our problem is that we're not studying the being. It's a sign of the last days when Muslims are going to be studying knowledge in great numbers, but they won't be studying being. Someone comes up and says, what do you do? And he says, well, I'm a hospital. And they look at him like, hospice? I mean, you know, I understand it, but what do you do? What do I do? I'm a hospice, a Quran. I'm an imam. I'm an iron. No, it doesn't mean anything. It's like, well, you got to eat, man. You understand what I'm saying? But if someone says, well, what do you do? You say, well, I'm a doctor. Oh, mashallah. This is the problem with us right now. Because we are looking at Islam from the perspective of those who take Islam, those who take the Prophet of Allah, those who take the Muslims, those who take the Quran, those who take the Sunnah, and we end up trying to be like them instead of being like the Prophet Muhammad of Allah, in our character and in how we approach this life. We live for this life and the next life. And it's the problem. And all these other things that we talk about, the prison issue, you know, the division among Muslims, that's all part of dunya. It has to be dealt with. It has to be dealt with the being.
I'm sorry. I've been informed that we have to wrap this session up. I want to first thank you, but I want to hear a few words. We have an honest guest, Alderman Thomas from the Supreme Court. I want to have a few words. Do this reading, and then we want to come in.
Good afternoon. You know, I haven't been here very long, and I've heard just a little bit of what has to be said, and I like what I heard. You know, they were talking about people coming together. We need to come together, and I talk about this all the time. How much, you know, we're very, very, very powerful when we come together, and we can get anything we want. But the hardest thing to do is just what? Come together. We need to change. Because if we continue doing what we've been doing for the last 10 or 15 years, we're going to continue to get what we've been getting for the last 10 or 15 years, and we don't like it. So let's change. Let's come together and do what we need to do in order to prosper and be happy. I could sit here all day and speak my political views, but I'm not going to do that today. What I want to talk about right now for a very short period of time is coming together. Every time we come together, we get what we want. And we need to come together. We need to work together, socialize together, and do politics together. If we do that, we can take over our community. But right now, as long as we stay segregated, there's going to be others that come in and take over our community. So I'm going to finish right there. Let's come together, all right?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Alderman. Can we close by Dr. Keith? Remember, can we close? Can we close in dua, inshallah?
I just want to say the prayer, the universal prayer that incorporates everything, and that's just the basic fatiha that opens up everything. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. Anyone who did not understand that, pull me to the side and we can talk. Assalamu alaikum.